Five panelists, five topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they will manage.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, you know, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
But what I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.
Welcome to The Advocate on Plus TV Africa. Five panelists, five topical issues, no holds barred. We tell it like it is. So I'll be looking at the struggle of power in our educational system instead of focusing on the problem we have in our education system today. Nafisa will be giving us a blueprint of where our country is headed. Are we moving forward? What is our identity as Nigerians? I have a few words to say on that one. Liberals will similarly be highlighting some of the issues hindering our progress in Nigeria. You may be surprised that we are the ones doing ourselves. Now, wow. Treasurer will be teaching us how to be Nigerians, an ethical revolution. She makes reference to her very own Professor Wole Soyinka, Tunji Oyelano, and the likes. And Bolahan describes a peculiar relationship between diverse attitudes to challenges and opportunities by young ones. So you can see from our lineup, we are not averse to rocking the boat in the interest of genuine stability. So allow me to lead the way right after the break. It is said that at the root of every tantrum and power struggle are unmet needs, and I'll be speaking on much ado about Vice Chancellor. The recent disgraceful handling of the removal of the Vice Chancellor of University of Lagos is not the first fiasco. May not even be the last furore to be raised in that institution. Let's go back to before 1965, when Ajanwa Chukwu was Federal Minister for Education. It was alleged that in spite of the availability of more senior professors of Yoruba extraction, I might add, he handed the vice chancellor positions in universities of Ibadan and Lagos to two men of Igbo extraction, namely Kenneth Dike and Enin Joku, respectively. Now that's open to argument. However, the replacement with Saburi Biobaku, when the new minister came in Lagos, signaled the start of university heads who hailed from the local area for what were actually federal institutions. So, on resumption of office by Biobaku, there was chaos. The students did not want him, and they went on a rampage. It took some months before Biobaku actually got to work, and it was not before he was attacked and stabbed at his introduction ceremony by one Kayode Abraham, who was jailed and eventually killed himself by drowning on his release. Interesting that the office of VC is now tribalized like all that we see in today's current federal government. So why all the ado about VCs as vice chancellors? What's the attraction? Is it the money that they control by virtue of their office? Because as you know, money dictates the status quo in more or less all sectors of our nation. For the 5 or so years I spent at University College London, I never knew who the Vice Chancellor was, not ever. For me, it was such irrelevant information that when I was asked once on a holiday trip to Lagos back in the 1980s, I could not answer. We concentrate on all the wrong details here. Rather than discuss fundamental issues about the military, we spend our evening TV memorizing code names of supposed attacks on terrorists. Surely that's not our business, the code names, that is. If we spent more time discussing the failure of the education system rather than who gets to head a university, we might be in a better place today. Likewise, the bloody code names of Operation Cobra or something like that. Just get the damn terrorist out or dead. So let's put our energy and thinking to the right, proper, and economically sound issues and play down budgets, which is where we pilfer funds from. Let's begin to think strategies and drop the showbiz and glamour. To save Nigeria is not a task for the whimsical.
Fantastic.
Awesome.
No, really.
Let's drop the glamour and the showbiz. Yeah,
don't mind them. They're bringing it back already.
I'm saying it's awesome. Drop the glamour. Drop the showbiz.
Unfortunately, we can't.
Go straight. No, we can't. We can't really.
And that's why
we need to dictate the pace. And I like Chuka's advocacy. Instructive. Leave all of these code names. Leave who is the vice chancellor, who is INEC chairman. Mm-hmm. Get the job done. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to know who the governor is. I've been traveling to, you know, America now, and I never really bothered to ask, who's the governor of the state?
Yes, the state works, so it doesn't matter who is the governor.
So long as it works.
You know, I've never really asked myself, who is the electoral umpire in this country?
Yes.
You know, but here we are so particular about the man who occupies the office.
And the
where
deputy.
Where he's from.
And the deputy.
Where he's from. Because, like you said, you know, this... what determines how we PIFA.
Yes.
You know, it is what determines what comes
budget.
To us. So it's our turn.
It's quite unfortunate.
It's our turn to rule. Yes, that turn might give you sense of belonging, but it should be married with performance.
It's actually becoming a very dangerous trend. Yeah. I read in the papers that in the University of Ibadan, recently, the indigents, that's the Ibadan people, were requesting that the next VC should be from Ibadan.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I don't understand what that has got, even if it is not federal. As far as an educational institution is concerned, it should be who is the best for that environment at any point in time. So asking for an indigene, I think it runs contrary to all ethos that you can think about in that particular space.
It's happening even in churches these days. Though.
Even in churches?
Yes.
Even in churches?
Catholic bishop. Oh, the bishop should come
from. Bishop is from, not from the right place.
I think it may stem from the fact that some people feel marginalized and they feel they've been marginalized for too long. And they want to prove that, look, we also have competent sons and daughters that can do this as well. So why don't you field somebody from us? Because we have competent people as well. So if it's performance, we have performance as well. We have performance. So why don't you consider us? So then it goes back to the thing about Nigeria that we focus on the people who can deliver, irrespective of where they're from.
Like you've said, it's a big problem. Yeah, because you know when trust is breached, it takes time to rebuild. And so you find out that some of these people also, you know, there's a breach of trust somewhere. You believe that it is when your man is there that your people will get attention. Because when you're there and you're supposed to act and treat everybody evenly, and then you see favoritism, nepotism, corruption, you know, for a section of the people, and then people would definitely say, look,
that's when they,
let it
go round.
Let the butter come to us.
That's when they tell the points at their own sons and daughters and tell you they can also do it.
If we're equitable in the way we treat, you know, everybody, nobody would, will clamor for his turn. If the basic things are there, and we all can assess them by qualification.
By qualifications, not by favoritism.
Most of what you're referring to as a basic thing is not what is driving this thing. What is driving it is that when my person is there, then I'm closer to the cookie jar. That is the essence of what is going on. So it's not in the best interest of any environment, any society.
No, but what I'm saying is if it is on merit and not until your person is there, you get from the cookie jar. And then you know that whoever is there, you will definitely get
will
it
be
on
dealt
merit.
With fairness.
With fairness.
Okay, but how many people get there based on merit and fairness in Nigeria nowadays? There are a lot of competent people who are bypassing some of these appointments. And then they go and take somebody who is far less competent than
Then we need to check the process through which leaders emerge in all the spaces we're describing. What is the process? If the process is right, then there should be no point in getting worried.
Think what brought about Madame Due Process some years back. That's what brought about that particular ministry. And
the problem. You can't legislate due process from the top. It has to be an orientational thing. Alant Nefisat is with us now. I don't know. Nefisat, you have a contrary opinion or you concur with Chuka's advocacy?
beg to concur, Mr. Chuka.
Okay, so she agrees with you completely.
Well, it is clear that there is a power struggle over who will control the market. And Nafisa rises to the challenge after the break.